Releasing in late 2013, the iPad Air marked the second major redesign to the iPad line, third if you include the separately marketed iPad Mini. It broke the conventional naming scheme of numbers with the iPad 1, 2, 3, and 4, and took on the suffix Air in order to convey just how light and thin this iPad was. And indeed, it was one of the thinnest and most powerful tablets ever made, running the brand new iOS 7 with its complete aesthetic overhaul. Hey, how's it going? I'm Josh from 91Tech, and there's no question that the iPad Air is one of the biggest upgrades to the iPad line we've ever seen. What exactly made it so great, and could it still be useful today? The iPad Air is light, very light, and the compact form factor managed here is still impressive even now. In fact, this general shape and size is absolutely still being used today with the cheapest iPad Apple sells, except this came out back in 2013. It was 22% lighter than the iPad 4 from only a year before, a hugely impressive difference that might not sound like a lot, but can be felt immediately going from one device to the next. This iPad Air here is actually my grandma's and has been used by her for probably the better part of the last 6 years or so. The battery is completely shot, but beyond that, it manages to hold up shockingly well for everything she needs it for, most notably iMessage, Facebook, and general web browsing. It does die real fast after being unplugged, but it's something she's used to, and a battery replacement wouldn't be completely out of the question, assuming I did it myself, as Apple charges nearly as much for a new battery as they would for their cheapest iPad. Absolutely ridiculous, but besides the battery, this iPad Air has done really darn well. And it's a testament to how well built and designed it was nearly a decade ago. It also isn't too out of date in software support, although it does get worse each passing day, as it isn't updatable past iOS 12, not that you would really want it to be, as performance is fairly decent as is, and it likely wouldn't be on iOS 13 or better. And we are still receiving minor updates from Apple here, despite iOS 12 not being particularly relevant for a couple years now. And we're able to run this recent software thanks to the fantastic Apple A7 chipset, making this one of the first 64-bit tablets ever made, and allowing it to receive 6 major iOS versions in iOS 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and even better, feeling mainly smooth on each and every iteration. Even today, at least when plugged in and not struggling for juice, this iPad runs okay, with lag definitely happening, but the overall experience being absolutely usable. And before we really get into the device itself and how it holds up in modern times, I'd kind of like to go off about the tablet and the context surrounding its release, as I honestly believe it's one of the best and most interesting iPads Apple's ever made, and one that was pretty underrated 8 years ago. The fact that this iPad Air has managed to survive for so long without needing to be replaced is amazing, although my grandma could certainly do with an upgrade to be sure. But this is the benefit of buying Apple, consistent software support over the years, as a trade-off for the flexibility and customizability you would get with Android. And when the iPad Air came out in 2013, Android tablets were still very much a thing. Nowadays, they're kind of few and far between in terms of flagships, at least. Samsung still makes them, and so on, but you've probably heard it from a tech reviewer before, and it's true. The iPad has pretty much won the tablet war at this point, being the best overall option for the vast majority of people, particularly with their budget offerings. Not that their competition is all bad or anything like that, they can still be great, but again, for the average person, iPads just seem to be the way to go. And if you're worried about how those iPads will hold up in the future, the iPad Air is the perfect example of why not to be. Compare literally any Android tablet from 2013 or even 2014, and try to find one that genuinely holds up to the iPad Air, even if it was more expensive at the time. If you can do it, I'll be impressed, and Apple deserves credit for what they managed to achieve here. Not that the Air is perfect, however. Apple co-founder Steve Wozniak actually criticized the iPad Air for the focus on decreasing size and weight, as opposed to increasing storage space, an issue that might seem perhaps minor nowadays, but was a fair complaint for the time. This iPad Air does start with 16 gigabytes, and that's not great. I do have the 32GB model here. With the 16GB, there's not going to be much space for photos or apps, but you could always get the basic 50GB iCloud subscription for a couple bucks a month, which my grandparents all have, and it works great for them. It backs up their photos and gives them lots of extra space, so that's an option. But 16GB, definitely worth avoiding. Critical reception in 2013 was generally positive, but another criticism levied was how the iPad Air didn't seem to bring much past the design over the iPad 4, which in and of itself may have seemed like a smaller upgrade. update to the iPad line given how quickly it came out after the iPad 3. I'll debunk this momentarily, as we have the power of hindsight, and now know just how far that extra power in the Air went, but it's also worth mentioning there were complaints of a lack of fingerprint sensor, and that the improvements that did exist were just too minor to justify purchasing over the older models. And that might seem like a fair critique, but giving it some context does make it feel pretty baseless. The lack of Touch ID is a pity, to be sure, but the iPhone 5S had literally just brought it into Apple's devices at the time, and so while it would have been nice to have, let's not pretend that it was something super common in 2013. The negative review I'm kind of referring to here was actually featured on the Wikipedia page for the iPad Air, where I clearly get all of my accurate information, specifically from Dave Smith of the International Business Times. The article, iPad Air Review, Don't Believe the Hype, goes into how it's a great product, but not new, special, or different from any other iPad. Some of this can be written off as one single detractor that wasn't a fan of the iPad Air, and fair enough, probably not worth going into, so I won't. But I do want to emphasize that quickly approaching 10 years later, this opinion has clearly aged like milk that was likely already expired when bought off the shelf, just to show that the iPad Air was a pretty decent upgrade. The iPad 3 came out in early 2012 with Apple's Retina display, but mostly similar internals to the iPad 2, which resulted in an experience that would slow down quickly as updates kept piling on until iOS 9. Any device Apple made featuring those A5 chipsets perform horribly on their latest versions, and so it's kind of unsurprising that only later that year, in 2012, Apple replaced the iPad 3 completely with the iPad 4, upgrading the chipset to the A6. This gave a major performance boost that may not have been obvious at first, but would end up allowing updates all the way to iOS 10, and best of all, provide pretty great to decent performance on each and every software version, something that was less common than it should have been with older Apple devices around that time. Yeah, if you had bought the iPad 3 right at launch, I do have to feel sorry for you. I know my aunt did, and yeah, he kind of got ripped off considering the iPad 4 came out, what, around 6 months later? That's pretty brutal. But in that review, what good old Davey here missed was the A7 chipset and its 64-bit architecture made the iPad Air instantly one of the most powerful tablets ever built, and future-proofing it to a nigh-on absurd extent. It still runs decently enough today, and can download at least the latest compatible version of the majority of apps on the App Store, assuming your Apple account has downloaded them before. And these versions are pretty recent, and many apps you can still download the latest version straight up. All in all, the iPad Air has aged fantastically well. It was a big upgrade, those internal hardware changes were very underrated when they happened, but enough of exactly why I love the iPad Air, and how with hindsight it's easily one of the greatest tablets ever made. Let's take a step back here and look at the boldest feature the Air boasts, the gorgeous design. The iPad Air is a simple, thin, and light slab of aluminum with a sheer glass 9.7-inch Retina display on the front, hosting a strong resolution of 1536 by 2048, making for a pixel density of 264 pixels per inch, about the sweet spot for a tablet of this size, as all content displayed is sharp, crisp, and pleasant to the eye without visible pixels. It's actually the same pixel density used on the 10.2-inch iPad 8th generation released at the end of 2020, and also about the same as the most expensive iPad Pro. So yeah, it's held up pretty decently. Of course, displays have gotten better in other avenues, and one of the issues here is the non-laminated display, which means there is a bit of an air gap between the glass you touch and the content displayed on the LCD itself. This is still on the iPad 8 today, and on the iPad Air, it's forgivable given the age, and the next year's iPad Air 2 would bring the laminated display. So basically, this holds up very well. That iPad Air 2 would also add Touch ID, making this one of the last iPads to have the classic home button that has mostly disappeared from Apple's lineup at this point, minus the iPod Touch 7, weirdly enough. So if you want some security, you're going to be putting in your passcode really frequently. The iPad Air's biggest change was of course that whole new modern look, and one that actually had been done a year prior in the first iPad mini, although of course that one was a bit smaller. But there's no question that the iPad Air looks much newer and more modern than the iPad 4, even if there is only a year between them. I don't dislike the iPad 4's design, I actually quite like it. like it, but I do think the iPad Air was a really strong refinement of it, and there's a reason it looks so similar to what we have today. The back with that simple sheet of aluminum and the reflective mirrored Apple logo just looks really nice. Maybe a bit plain, but I'm not sure what else you would want to add to it. For colors, we didn't have many options with only silver and space gray, the silver having white bezels and the space gray having black bezels. I would have loved to see a black and slate iPad Air like the iPad Mini, but unfortunately Apple moved away from that color after 2012 as the paint wasn't durable, leading to chipping and scratching being way too common, as you can see on my old iPhone 5 here. But hey, the space gray is nice too, like this iPad Mini that was made in 2013, but is essentially the same as the 2012 iPad Mini. On the top of the iPad Air, we get the headphone jack, nice to see that, as nowadays only the cheaper iPads have them. And across from that, you have the power button, and then the volume buttons and mute switch along the upper corner. The iPad Air 2 would remove that switch altogether, which I always felt was probably the move to make on iPad. I remember back in the day multiple times helping relatives with their iPads that for some reason wouldn't play any audio, despite them turning up their volume. And yeah, that reason was almost always having that darn mute switch flicked on. On the bottom of the tablet is the Lightning port, just like the year prior's iPad 4. And there's not much else to talk about besides, man, does this design ever hold up? I can't get over that. The tiny little camera sensor at the top corner of the iPad Air wasn't improved from the iPad 4, at least in megapixel count. It's only got 5 megapixels, and although I'm not a fan of taking photos with tablets in the first place, the iPad Air unfortunately won't be doing a great job. It also can film video in 1080p, which is typical of the era. The selfie camera should probably be more important to you given how the iPad is essentially the perfect FaceTime machine, and it's good enough, albeit still pretty bad, with only 1.2 megapixels, again matching the 2012 iPad 4. It's the same that was in the iPhone 5S as well though, so it's tough to complain due to the time period, and it's totally enough for you to video chat, so I guess I can't whine too much here. I've rushed through the camera stuff because honestly, unlike a smartphone, iPads really aren't made to be photography machines. They can do the trick in the right situations, but it's infinitely more convenient to be able to fit a phone in your pocket and take photos with that instead of looking kind of ridiculous holding up your iPad to take pictures. No shame to you if you do that though, my grandparents have all done that over the years, and they're probably watching this video now, so love you, grandma, grandpa. Anyways, the camera is good enough to be viable for a 2013 tablet, and whether that's a good or bad thing is up to you. Moving to the more technical side of things, we have a quite large 8,820 milliamp hour battery that should provide decent life, assuming it isn't toast like it is on this iPad Air here. Seriously, this thing died quite a few times while I was filming it, and my grandma never uses it unplugged because there's no point. I'd say you have about 10 minutes before it conks out. Now this could be an easy fix if you replace the battery, but going through Apple as mentioned earlier is insanely expensive. At $250 American, that's ridiculous. And while I understand this iPad is a bit of an exception, as most older iPads in my experience tend to actually do pretty well in battery life as they get older, why on earth does Apple have to charge $250 to replace the battery? It's almost as much as the 10.2 inch iPad 8 at $329 US. So for $250, you can get the battery that pooped out a few years ago for seemingly no reason swapped, or for $80 more, you can get one of the latest and greatest iPads on the market. It's clear which one Apple wants you to choose, and it really bugs me. Regardless, she'll keep using it until it dies permanently, at which point she'll hopefully let me help her get a new one. The fact that the battery life is completely shot, but this iPad still remains a viable device 8 years later for her, does speak to how well future-proofed it was at its launch. And you can thank the A7 chipset and full gigabyte of RAM for this. The specs look old and rough on paper, but it's still enough to get you to iOS 12 and run the vast majority of everyday tasks for whatever you need to do. iOS 12 was a great optimization refinement update, and it's left older devices feeling really good. Performance is maybe mediocre, but it does run faster than you would expect, with lag definitely being around, but not too frequent or brutal. And because this is iOS 12, many apps again still kind of support it, with basic social media and streaming apps being usable without issue. And you could always get the latest compatible version if that app doesn't support it. Of course, this is going to change more and more as time moves on, and some apps might not support iOS 12 whatsoever, but still, it's very much something that can do most things 8 years later. If you have an old iPad Air lying around, it would be perfect for a kid or someone similar who just wants a big device to watch Netflix on and play some basic games. Web browsing is a bit slow, but totally usable as well. Compare this to the majority of laptops from 2013, and I bet I would choose this iPad nearly every time. As it stands right now, 8 years later, the iPad iPad Air is a usable device that hasn't yet fallen into the dark pit of complete obsolescence that I would say the iPad 4 probably has. And even that iPad and most older iPads honestly still can have their uses. Heck, my 5-year-old brother uses our family's old iPad 2 for Netflix and some basic games, and it works great for that. The iPad Air might still work nowadays, but that doesn't mean you should go out of your way to buy one. Not that I expect any of you plan to. It's shocking how much money these things still sell for, with most listings I found on eBay.com expecting ludicrous amounts of over $100 for a device in decent condition. I would never pay that, and I'd really avoid buying a used iPad in general, with that 10.2-inch iPad brand new from Apple only costing $330 US. That's a fantastic price point, and if you're struggling with an iPad Air or an older iPad, I really recommend upgrading at some point here, as you'll really appreciate those faster speeds and modernized experience. But if you don't have the money, you're still okay, at least on the iPad Air. All in all, iOS 12 with this iPad Air has managed to impress me so much more so than I expected, and I think Apple does deserve applause for how well designed and built this iPad was back in 2013. It's a great device in spite of the age, and one that I actually myself could use if I had to. Might not be ideal, but it would work, and yeah, so with that, I think I'm right about done here. Basically, iPad Air kinda still good despite being 8 years old. Do any of you still use the first iPad Air? How does it work for ya? Make sure you let me know in the comments down below. If you found this video interesting, maybe hit that like button and consider subscribing for more content just like this. You can follow me over on Twitter and Instagram at 91_tech if you'd like to for some reason. And we do have a Discord link in the description. Come by and say hi. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Josh from 91 Tech, and I will see you all next time.